Double click on it. There you go. Two clicks. One click, two clicks. Seems like a pretty important thumb drive to have there, didn't it?
Good evening. I would appreciate the opportunity to update you on the capital improvement projects. The main two right now would be the Madison Elementary School project and the Caroline County High School project. The Madison Elementary project is basically in design right now. We were a little bit of delay on the project due to weather and trying to get the land purchased. As of yesterday or today, we have an additional 6.9 acres that we will be getting surveyed, and it's a very important piece of land because it'll give us access for parking our buses. And hopefully it'll be going out for bid in the month of June. This is a rendering of what you will see, and the yellow areas are where there will be additions to the school or expansions of the school. Most of the internal stuff in the light blue area has already been done. The only thing that will be upgraded there will be fire alarm, and we will be putting in intercom systems or phones so all teachers will have access for safety. The area at the top corner over by the gym, and I don't have a pointer with me, but there's a little strip of yellow. That area is okay, right in that area right there, that is going to be enclosed, and that will be the main entrance area from the bus area. The other addition that you'll see is over here in the cafeteria. We're going to expand the cafeteria area so that we can seat additional students, and there will be two serving lines that will make that school more compliant, and we'll be able to shorten their lunch periods a little bit and give the children more time to eat. This is the main expansion that you will see, which is the front area. And you can see a new visitor parking area right here. And this will be teacher parking, and this will be bus parking. The main area will have a secure entrance where the students will come in, parents or visitors will come in, have to go into the main door, be buzzed in, then they will enter into the office before they can proceed into the main building. There's four additional kindergarten classrooms in that area, a new library, that is sorely needed with computer labs, guidance wing, and office area. The old office area is going to be converted into resource rooms for special ed. This is a layout of what I just shared. You can see the light blues. And also what's going to be very unique about this building is you'll have two different courtyards, two there, and then you'll have one there. We will not be able to put an upper courtyard because of access, egress, and there will be additional bathrooms put in here so the students won't have to go all the way around to school. It'll help to enclose the school and provide, again, a safer environment. But the biggest thing that it'll do is help us to get rid of the trailers that run along this area right here, right now. Those will disappear in this layout. This is a rendering of what you will see when you come to the front of the school now, in the future. Caroline High School track resurfacing. The reason this was picked is this is a major safety issue. One of the concerns is that the track is deteriorating. We've had students fall or people fall on the track. It has been out for a while. We actually are in good shape because of some of the things that we've found out through speccing it out. It is what the board has chosen to do and to look at first. The cost and the prices are probably better than what we were expecting, and that package is now going out and will be bid out here, and we'll begin the process. Here's what the track will look like. Again, you can see that before the runways were here for long jump and triple jump, they've been moved. to correlate with the high jump pit over here and the pole vault pit. All of this will be reworked. You'll see it where there'll be better drainage, and that field does hold a fair amount of water at this point, but it will be fixed and the track will be resurfaced. Everything will be ground down and new asphalt and new rubberized track will be put on. This is the drainage layout to try to move the water off of the track or off the field a whole lot better. And here's a picture of what, a rendering of what the track will look like. It'll be the typical black 8-lane with all the markers on it. Next will be the high school additions. We're in the process of completing the renderings and the work and collecting all the information on the high school. Hopefully we'll be bid by around August 13th so that we can begin work early September. Go ahead. We have the two main additions, and you can see the green. The dark green areas are where is major internal renovation will happen and major work where we're converting space either into classrooms or totally upgrading it as required and needed. You can see the areas, and you can see the openness of the cafeteria. That should probably be dark green too. The cafeteria will definitely no longer be two cafeterias. There won't be a red and a blue. It'll be a reddish blue because they'll be combined. So we finally got to that point. Enough classrooms added that we will be able to hopefully handle 1,400 to 1,600 students as we go forward. This is the new main area, office area, guidance suite. This is the old part of it, which will be converted into classrooms. Again, a secure entrance. Again, parents have to be buzzed in. Once they're buzzed in, they come into the office and they can get access to the building, easier access to the nurse, guidance counselors, and so forth without having to go into the main building. We have a new library addition that will have its own entrance and its own bathroom so it can be used for night meetings and night activities without having to open access to the entire building. The complex over here for the gym is here, and they're putting in many of the needed facilities that have been requested over the years. The auditorium will have a total upgrade of the sound system and the seats, but we're going to maintain it at 400 to 500 people can be in that auditorium at one time. Main group meetings will be held in the gym area. This is what the rendering, what people see when they're coming up 207. And there's still a little bit of work to do on that. And this is another view coming up 207 towards Bowling Green, what they will see when they're coming up 207. I really want to take a, before we get into this part, I want to take a moment to thank all the teachers, all the people that have been involved. I know Kevin Whiteman's been involved a great deal. A lot of meetings have been occurring. I know that there's going to be another meeting Thursday with the high school, and we're trying to keep it up. To give a breakdown, this is what we used to estimate back the price of what the $21 million piece of it, and the actual price on this is, you can see the building renovations, which include HVAC, electrical, locker room, science, cafeteria, library, administration, roof replacement, ADA upgrades, interior, finish, and was a subtotal of $8.6 million. Building additions were the new entrance lobby, administrative guidance, media, new classrooms, culinary expansion, new gym, concessions, team rooms, weight rooms for $9 million. And then the bleacher repair for site costs, running track resurface, athletic facility upgrades, miscellaneous site improvements for additional fields, basically, is what that was, coming in at $1.4 million, and then other miscellaneous costs, fees, testing, surveys, and architectural fees and project cost at $2 million. And that is our presentation.
Dr. Keeler, we thank you very much, and the citizens thank you very much for the information presented. Board members at this time have any questions? Mr. Black?
Yeah, I just have a couple. Well, thank you for showing up, Dr. Kilo. I just got a quick question. It goes back to the last project. Where are we on the Bowling Green project? I know this is, what is the status there? I know we had some issues with, there were some issues going on. Have those been resolved, or what's the deal?
We are still working through with the contractor at this point. Today, I met with the architect. We're sending a response letter to the Mr. Lockridge requesting, giving him a clear directive on, he gave us an option on the floors where he was going to put down, what's that called? It's a cementous terrazzo. It's a white color that we were saying that we want put throughout the building to cover the floors. They need to go in and cut out where those cracks are and put in the correct fill and joiners there to make sure that those cracks don't expand so that once they put that new cap on top, it won't crack it immediately. We have 76 punch item list items left to do that we have asked for a timeline and a timetable to do. We've been working closely with our architect and our attorneys, and we are at a point where we're continuing to get his charges for our out-of-pocket expenses. We're still holding about $986,000 at this point.
Okay. And what is, just out of curiosity, do you have an ETA on, when this project, that project will be completely finished off? I mean, we'll have all the, I mean, do we have, because it was originally, you open up the building when? I mean, it was the original opening was the school year, right? I mean,
right.
And we're still having problems. I mean, we still get, there's still issues somewhat.
The issues mainly are that, you know, he's being assessed starting back in August. Liquidated damages of $500 a day.
Right, and I understand that.
If we push, I've done enough homework and discussion that if we push too much, he can ask for comebacks or say that, you know, he can, we've limited change orders mammothly in that project. There's minimal, if hardly any, left.
Right.
So we're just sitting here waiting for the summer because he's going to need the summer mainly to get in and do those floors. We are trying to look at trying to do a small sample area on the floor before school's out. We found an area. Our goal is to get the project done by the end of this summer. But again, that comes down to the contractor fulfilling his obligations and his requirements.
Okay. I guess I'd just like to kind of make a statement. I guess the cost of that project is what, 10.5? Was the 10.5 put into that project? So we had $10.5 million put into that project. As Mr. Akers, I want to reiterate something Mr. Akers said in his opening board comments. This is $25 million of taxpayer money. And I'm sure I'll be facing the same thing next week at a constituent meeting that Mr. Akers faced, you know, yesterday at his. And that is, this project is going to be bigger than any of us up here. I would imagine that we would be expecting this to last 25, 30 years. So it is absolutely imperative from our perspective, if we're spending taxpayer money, it's absolutely imperative that this is done correctly.
And I would agree. I would think that there's a little bit of a misnomer. You have a great project in Bowling Green. You have an issue with that we're addressing with floors. You know, it's like any other project that you have that I've witnessed or been a part of before. Once that project and those floors are corrected like they will be and the school board has done and been very protective of the community's money, and they're continuing to hold the contractor accountable. We're actually in a very good seat right now. If we need to, we have to go through the process. There is a process that we need to follow that's a legal process, and, you know, I need to be very careful where I go there because, you know, we're still monitoring the project and trying to work with the contractor to get things done. I have no other recourse but to follow that process and to step through those paths. Once that project is completed, you got a heck of a project for $10.5 million. The taxpayers should be extremely proud of it. And, you know, there's hopefully going to be, you know, money that'll be left over from this project because of all the savings that have happened because of no change orders and many other things that were done in that project to cut costs.
And I sometimes don't I agree with you 100%, but sometimes it's public perception, and when people are reading in a newspaper that the floors are having to redone in a brand new school, or they're, you know, I mean, it's public perception. And I'm just saying, if we're spending $25 million in Caroline High School and Madison Elementary. I'm sure, I mean, I'm not going to speak for the board, but I'm sure we want, you know, the citizens want to say, hey, this thing, we're not going back and we're not redoing floors at Caroline High School, we're not redoing a roof at Caroline High School, we're not redoing an HVAC system once this thing is in place.
Sounds good.
That's my concern, so yes. Thank you.
Mr. Underwood?
No comments, Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Akers?
No questions.
Mr. Sealing?
I'm going to strike one chord that I've struck, and I just want to make sure we're all clear. We're only doing the track this summer, nothing else in the back. We're not spending anything above the track dollars, so that in the event we need those dollars in the building during the renovation, they'll be available. Is that correct?
Yes. Let me add to that, because I want to clarify that. It is the track. It is the football field. The drainage is all one component. We are going to go back, and Mr. Honan is going to, because of the land behind, we're going to go ahead and get the trees removed, which we had shared with you in our meeting, and we've been working with Mr. Cully on. Those are the only things that you're going to see done this summer.
So we should have additional funds in that line item for exterior, sort of behind the building, field stuff in the budget that would be done at the end?
Or as part of the project, yes, if the project comes in at cost. Right.
Okay, thank you.
All right, Dr. Kilo, thank you again. This is kind of what you said at the board chairman's meeting. We understand, and it's good to have an idea. Doesn't have to be a perfect idea, doesn't have to be line item, but we kind of get a feel of what each phase could cost. And of course, you are going to be wise and put options in there, so people that saw that number won't bid a dollar less than that number, so they know exactly what it is. But we'll have some way to make options and change a little. So we're getting back to Bowling Green. We're getting $15,000 a month in liquidated damages.
That's correct.
And we've been,
we're over $135,000 at this point.
So you're at 8 months. Yeah. I don't think we're going to spend that money. You're not going to spend that money, are you?
Not without coming to you guys first, of course. We're going to work.
That was actually not the point of my question.
I was just trying to jump ahead. No.
Okay. Okay.
We do not need that in the project at this point, Mr. Thomas. I'm hoping that when we get the project done, we get all the change orders, we collect the utilities that they owe us, the water fees that they owe us. We had a reverse change order, which I call reverse change order, where we did some work ourselves that we had agreed with the contractor, and he owes us for all that.
Right.
We should be in very good shape. Yes, sir.
Okay.
And I want to say one other thing. I really do thank you all, and I did appreciate the meeting and I really appreciate that you guys care and are really pushing that we get a great project here. I really think it's been a good partnership, and I appreciate the continued interest in making sure that we're doing what's best for this community.
Well, that's the point. The last thing I wanted to say on Bowling Green is I did send you an email. We talked about it Friday. I sent you an email Monday regarding the drainage issues and the possible loss of revenue there. So you're supposed to look at that tomorrow?
Tomorrow.
Okay.
Tomorrow, or I believe today it was shared, Thursday they were going to run elevations.
Sightlines.
And once elevations are run and they check everything back, we've got some plans in hand to try to fix and address. We're going to do something anyway.
Yeah, because you're kind of the shorthand in this because you don't have the easement document back. That's my understanding. So we need to make sure we take care of this issue, because that's going to be really expensive to try to move that road. So that's it. And the reality, back to what you said, this is a school board project. The Board of Supervisors got behind it to get the referendum passed. We want you to have a good project. We've offered our services to help. As a matter of fact, in the agenda later on, we're going to give you our services again. So it's ours. We're all in this together. We want to all come out of this alive and happy and friends. So we're going to work together. Sometimes we may not want to, but we're going to work together to make this work. So that's the reality, and we wish you the best of luck.
All right. Thank you.
And if you need anything, let us know.
Thank you.
Okay. Mrs. Hatcher, we kind of did things a little out of order. We did the treasurer's report, and then we got over here to something else, and now you're going to tell us about the third quarter budget report.
Yes, sir. Good evening.
Good evening.
Chairman Thomas, members of the board. In your packet, you've had the third quarter budget status report, which is for the 9 months ending March 31st. This report is on an accrual basis. Revenue collected this year for the last fiscal year has been backed out. Also included in this report is a cash basis column for all funds except utilities and schools. And for the fourth quarter report, you won't even see the cash basis column anymore. As you can see, in the attached summary is 57.7% of the budgeted revenues for the major funds have been collected or billed. 66.1% of the budget expenditures have been expended for the major funds. Your general fund revenues are $22,976,274, or 54.3% of the budget estimates. On the cash basis, property tax collections are slightly lower than the same quarter 2013. Your sales tax revenue does appear to be increasing after several quarters of decline, and I believe this is partly due to some construction projects, use tax on construction projects. Your local community tax and communication taxes appear to be slightly lower, and I think that will be a trend from now on out. Your business license collections are slightly lower in comparison to last fiscal year. Recordation taxes are lower, but your permits and fees are higher than the same quarter last year. Charges for services are above last year's levels, and fines and forfeitures are higher than last year's level at 67.2% of budget. So that's coming up. All other revenue categories are lower. Overall expenditures in the general fund are below the 75% threshold, as are most of the departments. All departments continue to be conservative in spending, and that's about the best we can do. School revenues are 61.6% of budget, and expenditures are 61.4% of expenditures or budget. Social service revenues are 65.6% of budget, and your expenditures are 72.1% of budget. Both revenues and expenditures for social services are higher than the same period last year, and it's estimated that they will be higher than the budget. Your CSA revenues and expenditures are well below the 75% threshold, but your expenditures are 10% higher than last year, and that will escalate before the end of the year. Debt retirement reflects revenues of 63%. Your meals tax revenues are higher than the same quarter last year, which I believe are due to the opening of McDonald's, 7-Eleven, and the reopening of the Golden Corral. Expenditures are 86.8% of budget due to the timing of the debt service payments. Your operating revenues for the utility fund standing at 74.2% of budget, representing 9 months of billings. Your operating expenses for the utility fund is at 61.5% of budget, well below the 75% threshold. Your debt service for the utility fund is 95.4% of budget. It should be noted again that your operating revenues continue to be greater than your operating expenses in the utility fund. For the nine-month period, operating revenues were $573,966 higher than the operating expenses, which goes towards debt service payments. Availability fees are doing much better this year. We've collected 34.5 water connections and 33.5 sewer connections. And it's equal to 84.6% of your budget. Dawn Wastewater Fund billed operating revenues are right at 75% of budget. The operating expenses are at 90% of budget. Debt services at 100% of budget. Tourism reflects 38.9% of revenue collected, 52.7% of expenditures. Transient occupancy taxes did show a slight increase for the third quarter, which is the first time in quite some time it's shown that. But it's still less than the total for 9 months of last year. Expenditures are well below the 75% threshold. And that's it for my report. Any questions?
Thank you, Mrs. Hatcher. You said something, revenue is less than it was last year during your presentation.
Which category?
Overall is what you said, yeah. And, but expenditures are as well.
Yes.
So is there anything in here that would be a red flag to you or something that you would say we need to pay attention to specifically, or it looks as if this is the typical third quarter?
It's a typical third quarter.
Okay. Now next year we'll lose a little bit of our meals tax when it goes to Port Royal.
That's correct.
So that's 60 or some thousand dollars will... Oh, yeah, we'll lose whatever B-pole is there, too. Okay.
Totally.
Okay. All right, any other questions for Ms. Hatcher? No questions? Ms. Hatcher, thank you very much.
Thank you.
All right, I'm not going to do this appointment, so consent agenda. Anything anyone would like to remove from the consent agenda or have a question answered?
I would like to pull item J, Mr. Chairman.
J, advertise for public hearing? Okay. I think he's going to ask Mr. Fincham. Anything else? Motion to approve the consent agenda items A through I, K, and L would be in order.
So moved, Mr. Chairman.
Is there a second to the
second.
Motion? Motion made by Mr. Underwood, seconded by Mr. Black. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, nay. The motion carries unanimously. Authorization to advertise public hearing for RZ09-2005. Mr. Fincham can help us. Is this the one where they just want to remove the age restriction?
Yes, sir. This is the residential rezoning for 8 lots that previously went before the board for 2 public hearings. It was deferred by the board at the applicant's request and has been sitting there ever since the last deferral by the board. The applicant has requested that this item be brought back forward to the board and to proceed with the application. And the appropriate action, if the board agrees to do that, would be to advertise for a public hearing again on this item, recognizing that there are likely to be some changes to the application, the removal of the age restriction on the housing, perhaps some other modifications related to design, but the appropriate action would be to come back to public hearing.
Before we approve that, there is no financial impact to the county with these changes of the proffers.
Well, if you remove the age restriction, then arguably you might be increasing the potential for school-aged children to attend the school system.
Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Akers.
And I remember this particular application coming before the board a number of years ago. It's been a long time. The concerns were about the age-restricted housing was, and that's something we couldn't figure out at the time, is how do you police that? How do you make sure that it's not someone going to buy and then have children in the process or in the housing development? I'm not comfortable with what we have here. And I indicated that to Mr. Fincham earlier. I would like for it to be pulled from the agenda completely and let us talk about it and talk about the proffers. The age restriction was not the only issue with this application. There were other issues as well. And so I think we need to make sure that we have processed those in addition to the age restriction and to see if the age restriction is... better for the county overall, as far as cost is concerned. So if you would, if the board would allow, just let us pull it,
right.
Go back and talk about these issues. And I've indicated maybe March, September time frame as far as moving along to the public hearing, if that's required.
Okay. And this is this particular request or rezoning is in the Madison District.
Yes, sir.
So, of course, we give Mr. Akers the courtesy of you know, whatever delay or whatever investigation you'd like to do. That's fine. And since we're just talking about it really for the first time, I think most of the other board members that ask questions about it, and I've got one in my district, when there is a significant impact to the county, such as I'm not going to build a road, that's one of the proffers I want to take out, or I'm not going to give you X amount of dollars, I think we all pay a lot of attention to that.
Oh, absolutely.
Things in this case where we're fine-tuning how to work things out, no problem. So if you'd like to pull it, that's the will of the board. Are you going to say I need a motion? We don't need a motion. So if that's your desire, we're just going to pull that from the agenda. We'll bring it back when the planning department sees fit. All right?
Okay.
Thank you, Mr. Fincham. That covers our...